الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على خاتم النبيين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. اللهم ربنا زدنا علما. Dear brothers, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Continuing, we have started in this درس. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى reward us all for what we are sitting for. Just to remind myself and remind you also that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have told us that people who sit to talk about Quran and Sunnah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward them with so many rewards. The first reward will be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remember them among the malaika in the seventh sky, the mala' al-a'la. The second reward, that malaika will take care of them while they are sitting. The third reward, that before they leave and when they are going to leave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them that leave with full forgiveness. Allahu Akbar. This is only by sitting in the masjid, listening to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, to what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, to what Sahaba and the good scholars have said, just to help each other to know and learn and remember the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, deen of Islam. We started in the beginning, we said that we have to talk about the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam, piece by piece. That hadith which is containing the five pillars of Islam, the six pillars of Iman, Ihsan, and the Sa'ah or time, which is the all this earth and the people on earth will die, which is Yawm al-Qiyamah. The signs of it, what will happen. We started to talk about the first pillar of Islam, and we said, don't be bored when we are going to go in details and details, because you and I, both of us, we need really to go into these details. We need, because our life is really getting us so busy. In fact, too busy to think about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to do, to think about the reason we are created in this earth. As Allah told us in His holy book, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. يعني He subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for only one reason only, that's to worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is our job, this is our duty, this is our mission in this life. Eating, sleeping, other things is only to help us to do this mission. These are materials, these are tools to be used in order to be capable of doing this mission that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for. Again to say, we said that the first pillar of Islam is shahadatayn. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We started to talk about Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, the first part of the first pillar. And we're still talking about it. Yet we are not yet received, or we are not yet reached to talk about Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the second part of the confession. Let's go for it. Let's talk about the case, because it's the important case that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent 10 years in Mecca talking about nothing but la ilaha illallah. We said la ilaha illallah will not be beneficial to the person who says it unless he has three conditions to know the true meaning. This first confession, first condition, to practice it, to be free of contradictions of it. Unless these three conditions are there, whoever says la ilaha illallah will not be beneficial of it. No benefit will be got from La ilaha illallah, at least these three conditions are there. How did we gather these conditions? How did we know them? By reading the Holy Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By reading the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From these two sources of Islam, we knew that just saying La ilaha illallah by tongue is not enough. Saying La ilaha illallah by tongue and believing inside by heart is not also enough. But also, practicing in life is a must. As we said in the last time we met, which is last week. Tonight we need to talk about the third condition, which will take us a little bit of time. Why? Because we really need to be safe from falling into one of these contradictions. Give you an example of saying that a person who is praying five times a day, not only five times but more, fasting Ramadan and more, paying zakah and more, going for Hajj once and Umrah once and more, this guy is mashallah, a very good guy. But if he falls into shirk, as an example, one of these contradictions, whether shirk or other cases, all these good deeds will be lost, fruitless, useless, nullified. So in this case, we must learn these contradictions to avoid falling into it, to be safe from falling into it. We have a good example as we say it. Maybe you heard it before. Let's repeat it sometimes. We say that imagine a good Muslim makes complete wudu, as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to do. MashaAllah, he washes hands three times, he makes madmada istinshaq three times, he washes his face three times, his hands, okay, till elbows, and so on. And he left his house going to the masjid to make salah. While he was on the way to salah, to the masjid, he lit air. Excuse me for this word. He lit air up. His wudu now is broken. But this guy, still we say imagine, he continued to go to the masjid. And he prayed the salah. And before salah he prayed to rak'ah. Maybe he recited some Quran. Okay, after salah he made also ratibah. He made istighfar and so on. What do you think of his salah? Unfortunately, useless, fruitless, nullified, broken. Why? Why? Because he lost the most important condition, which is wudu. So he's no more in wudu now. He cannot make salah. Salah is not accepted. As Muhammad SAW told us in the hadith, لا صلاة إلا بوضوء. لا صلاة إلا بوضوء. Without wudu, salah is not accepted. Even if a person forgets. Take an example. If someone comes to the masjid thinking that he has made wudu and he prayed salah, recited Quran, made ratiba and so on, and after he finished all this he remembers that he did not make wudu, he must repeat his salah. Subhanallah. Why? Because he was not in wudu. So wudu is a must condition for salah. And again to say, these contradictions will break Islam, break La ilaha illallah, like this letting air breaking the wudu and breaking the salah. So then we understand the importance of learning these contradictions to avoid falling into it, one case. Also to call our Muslim brothers and help them out not to fall into it, which is the mission of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As he told us in the hadith, أَنَا آخِذٌ بِحِجَزِكُمْ عَنِ النَّارِ أَنَا آخِذٌ بِحُجَزِكُمْ عَنِ النَّارِ. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us that he is saving us from falling into hellfire by falling into shirk or mocking to the religion or falling into magic and so on, of these contradictions which we will talk about inshallah later on. In this case, since it's clear to us now the importance of learning these contradictions, then we have to talk about it a little bit in detail. What was the first contradiction? The most and the worst sin ever happened by a human being is polytheism or shirk. Polytheism, shirk, is the worst sin that ever human being has done. إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَئِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ and so on. Piece by piece we'll study this. We'll talk about it because it's important for us when we see ourselves and see our Muslim brothers how they are falling into shirk one way or another and losing all of their good deeds. How do you feel? How do you feel if you see your brother or your sister or your father or mother or your son losing his money? How do you feel? Don't you feel that you want to do your best to save his money for him? Yes, of course. What if he's losing his deed? What if he's losing Jannah? He's falling into hellfire. Will you allow him to do this? No way, no way. These Muslims are our brothers. We are having the same deen. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةِ إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةِ We are brothers. As Allah told us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, هُوَ سَمَّاكُمُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِ We are brothers in Islam. It's not true at all that a Muslim can see his brother in Islam falling into some wrong things and he's keeping silent. No. He must do his best to save his brother from falling into these contradictions. Starting with the case of shirk, na'udhu billahi min ash-shirk. We have to talk about it clearly. Why? I tell you the truth. You will not find such a sin spread among Muslims like this sin, na'udhu billah. Go around, so see your brothers in Islam around, what you will see? Unfortunately, you will see good Muslims, but instead of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only, they are falling into the big mistake by asking someone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shirk, polytheism, is the greatest sin. It is the greatest sin as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His holy book told us, that this is the worst sin that ever human being has done. As we said before, we mentioned that the first time the human being fell into shirk, it was in the 10 centuries after Adam alayhi salam. 10 centuries after Adam alayhi salam, people were in monotheism from Adam alayhi salam, our father. And for 10 centuries, continuously, human beings were monotheists. But an accident happened. A case, a tragedy happened. That was when five pious people died almost in the same time, as Allah told us in His holy book, with their own names. وَلَا تَذَرُنَّ آلِهَتَكُمْ لَا تَذَرُنَّ آلِهَتَكُمْ وَلَا تَذَرُنَّ وَدًّا وَلَا سِوَاعًا وَلَا يَغُوثَ وَيَعُوقَ وَنَسْرًا Five people died in very close time. That was the time when shirk or polytheism started. Those people, the people around these five persons, they were so sad. So shaitan came to them. And shaitan, he tries always, as he promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he will try to take all human beings, the sons of Adam, into hellfire. فَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ So he promised and he swore to Allah that he will do his best to take us all with him to hellfire. Since he has guaranteed hellfire, na'udhu billah, he wants us to go with him. So what he did, he used tips. As Allah told us in the Holy Book, وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ Tips of shaitan. He first came to these people and he said, these five good people died at the same time. Why don't you try to remember them? So you will remember their good worshipping. Okay, fine. What shall we do? Why don't you draw pictures for them? Draw pictures for these good people, so when you see them, you will remember their good worshipping, their good jobs, their good deeds. So you will try to copy them also. Piece by piece, generation after generation, people started, instead of worshipping Allah only, they started to share and associate these five people and giving them some of what Allah only knows, or Allah Ta'ala only deserves. The human being, unfortunately, sometimes if they do not know Islam clearly, they are very easy victims of shaitan. So how do we save ourselves from shaitan's tricks? Very easy also. Very easy by what? By being with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting you, nobody can touch you. But we are the ones who are leaving this protection. We are not asking this protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we are losers. If we have the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no one can touch us. So we need the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How? By learning his book subhanahu wa ta'ala. By learning the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By practicing la ilaha illallah in our life. By being free of the contradictions of Islam. Shirk is to associate a partner with Allah. That could be in rububiyyah side, as we said last week. We said Tawheed is three sects. Rububiyyah, Lordship, Uluhiyyah, Worship, Names and Qualities, Asma wa Sifat. These three sects, we made them this way, or scholars made them this way to make it easy for us to learn, although they are all together. Okay, so shirk also or terrorism could be by one of these. Take some examples. Shia or Rafida or Imamis or Ja'faris, whatever you call them. They have polytheism in Rububiyyah side, Lordship side. How? Remember we said we defined shirk, Rububiyyah, we defined Rububiyyah Tawheed, Tawheed side of Rububiyyah, or Rububiyyah side of Tawheed. We defined it this by saying believing in the oneness of Allah in His deed. Like what? Creation, providing rizq, so on. Rabidah, they broke this Tawheed, or this half of Tawheed, by saying that Ali ibn Abi Talib and his descending 12 sons, they know the ghaib or unseen world. While clearly in the holy book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He told us, قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ إلا الله. Only Allah knows the ghaib, knows the unseen world. These people say no, this is not true. Astaghfirullah. Ali ibn Abi Talib knows. Al-Husayn, Al-Hasan, and so on, the descendant sons, they know Al-Ghayb. A'udhu Billah. So they broke this type of Tawheed, which is Rububiyyah type, by saying that there's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the ghaib, also Ali ibn Abi Talib, his descendant sons. This is just an example. Sufism also, some of these Sufis, of course, Sufis especially, they are falling into the same mistake by saying that their awliya, their qutub, knows the ghaib, control the world, and so on. One of these extremist Sufis in Afghanistan, I don't want to give names actually, but he used to say that this universe is controlled by four qutub. Qutub is the highest wali. The highest wali called Qutub in Arabic. So he says that this universe is controlled by four Qutub. Subhanallah, where is Allah? Where is before Allah? Subhanallah al-Azim. So they are falling into shirk or polytheism in the Rububiyyah Lordship type of Tawheed. That's an example. Also shirk could happen also especially in the site of Uluhiyyah, which is worshipping site, which is the widespread among Muslims, unfortunately. What is that? It is to give anything the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to these human beings, or these dead people, or trees, and so on. So if someone believes or goes to a grave to visit him, no. If he goes there to ask him instead of Allah or with Allah, he is falling into shirk. Why? Because dua is one of the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. And no one should be asked for things that by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only, should not be asked to any other person except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like what? Asking for rizq, for children, for healing, for curing from sickness, and so on. Look around, look around. You see our Muslim brothers, unfortunately, going to this grave to ask them for rizq or for healing. Or unfortunately, you will find millions of Muslims are doing this action. Also, shirk or polytheism could happen in the side of names and qualities. How is that? By giving the names of Allah or the qualities of Allah to others than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because these are only for Allah. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Only for Allah, the good names, the best names are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. That's why we call ourselves Allah, Abdullah. Ar-Rahman, Abdul Rahman. Al-Aziz, Abdul Aziz. Al-Ghafur, Abdul Ghafur, and so on. Somebody asked me, what about if we shorten the name, say Ghafur, Aziz, Kareem? That's dangerous. Although sometimes, Allah cannot. Ar-Rahman cannot. But like Rahim, Rahim is a description. If it's given to a human being, it could be. وَبَشَّرْنَاهُ بِغُلَامٍ عَلِيمٍ. Alim is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah will describe the son of that man, Zakariya, that he is Alim. So, description in here differs than the description in there. As we'll talk about names and qualities, inshallah, in details and why, when we talk about the rules of it. So if the name is the same, it does not mean the name is the same. What I wanted to say is that polytheism could happen on one of these three sects also, or all of them even. Now, if it is this way, then we need really to see the dangerousness of shirk. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about the dangerousness of shirk. How Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned us from the dangerousness of shirk. Let's take it piece by piece, although it will take us a while. That doesn't mean, inshallah, that we will lose our time. The first case to talk about the dangerousness of shirk and say it is the greatest sin, that shirk is likening the creator to his creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is raising the creature, whether it is a grave or a human being or a tree or so on, raising it to the level of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by asking that dead person or that tree or that cow or so on. Things that only can be done by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here is three important points some people they misunderstand. It means I cannot ask anything from other people. I cannot say, Muhammad, give me water. No, that's not what we mean. We are talking about things that only can be done by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like what? Like what? Like forgiveness. Like rizq. Like hearing. It's only by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's only by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do the reasons to gain these, but we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is clear in his book. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Call me. That's it. Only him subhanahu wa ta'ala. But for other things, it is okay to call people for help, for giving money, help to carry something. That's okay. With three conditions, of course. It's called APC. Alive, capable, and present. Alive, present, capable. APC. APC, if a person is alive, not dead. And if the person is present, not absent. The person is capable, not handicapped, an example. Then we can ask him to help us. Can we ask the dead person to help us to carry something heavy? He's dead. He is dead. Or can we ask a person who is not in here, far away, can we ask him to help us to carry something heavy? He's not there. Can we ask a handicap to carry something heavy with us? Of course, this is impossible. Except if the person thinks that this handicap or this dead person in the grave or that unpresent person having super power. Here comes the point where shirk comes in here. These people who come to the grave, they know this person is dead, but they say he has karamat, he has superpower, he is capable of. Why? How did you know? What's your proof? He says, this such and such person, he asked that grave, so he gave him. That lady, she was married for 10 years. She couldn't have a baby. When she went to such and such Khalandar Baba and just touched the tomorrow she had a baby. Stories that really nobody can understand, nobody can believe, except those people who do not have minds. Unfortunately, there are some scholars, they authored some books with this. I don't want to say this word, but it's true. Stupid story. Stupid story, truly. Why? Because when you read these stories as a good Muslim, you will understand these are impossible. This is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I told you that one of them, or some of them, they were in a ship in a very windy sea. The ship was going to sink because so much wind and waves, high waves. Then some of these people, this is the story of course, they asked such and such Khalandar Baba to help them. So that Baba came and carried the ship from that windy sea to another sea which is easy and no winds. Who will believe this? It's believed, unfortunately. That's why those poor Muslims, they are going to ask these graves. They go to these graves and ask them to do things that only can be done by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The case of presenting is also a case. It's a condition to ask people for things can be done by human beings. Otherwise it will be dangerous that he will go into the case of shirk. If someone calls a person far away from here, not in this masjid, somewhere else, he cannot hear us, and he said, help me out to do such and such, what will happen to the people around him? They will think that this person has some kind of superpower to hear us here while he is far away from here. Then he is giving him extra than a regular human being, extra than human being, extra to become to the godhood area, which is very dangerous, and so on. So the first thing to say that shirk is the greatest sin, it is the greatest zulm. Inna shirka la zulmun azeem. Because it is raising the human being to the level of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likening the creatures to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator. That's the hard zulm, which is not accepted. The second case to say that shirk is the greatest sin, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that he will never forgive a person who falls into shirk unless he repents before he dies. If he dies with shirk, Allah will never forgive him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. What less than shirk is possible to be forgiven. A person who steals or drinks alcohol or makes dinner and he dies without repenting, Allah may forgive him, and also may send him to hellfire for some time until he is cleaned from this dirty sin. Then he will bring him back to Jannah because he is a Muslim. But for shirk, no way. Allah has clearly told us
إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به.
So a person falls into shirk. Even if he is the best person in this earth by worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he falls into shirk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forgive him. He will send him to hellfire, as we will see in the second point or the next point.
So that is one of the cases to say that shirk is the greatest sin. We have to be careful with it.
The third case to say that shirk is the greatest sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that he forbids Jannah for a mushrik. A polytheist who die without repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jannah will be forbidden for him.
إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ
إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ
Jannah is haram for him. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbid Jannah for him, he will never, no way, get to Jannah.
What if he prays so much? What if he pays zakah so much? What if he fasts so many Ramadan and other things? Still, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbid Jannah for him.
إنه من يشرك بالله فقد حرم الله عليه الجنة
ومأواه النار.
This is another point also.
A mushrik, if he dies, the polytheist, if he dies without repenting, he will be settled in hellfire. يعني have no choice to leave Jahannam, نعوذ بالله. Because we know that Jahannam, the people who are going to settle in hellfire are kafirin, munafiqin, okay, and mushrikeen, polytheists. What about Muslims? Do they get to hellfire at all?
They do.
Those Muslims who fall into these major sins, kaba'ir, like zina, drink alcohol, and so on, those Muslims who come in the judgment day and they're scared very light with hasanat and very heavy with sayyat, they may go to hellfire, but for a certain time. But they will end up in Jannah, and they will be settled in Jannah. For mushrik, although he's praying, although he's fasting Ramadan and others, although he's saying zakah, although he's going for hajj, although he's saying ashhadu an la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, if he dies without repenting from shirk, major shirk, he will be settled in hellfire.
Na'udhu billah.
Put this in mind. We are trying to save ourselves and save our Muslim brothers. We see him in so many places asking things which is only from Allah, can be asked only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They ask it from the dead people. Go and see. See every Muslim country, unfortunately, except very limited countries, I would say, you will find Muslims going to the grave. To visit them? No. To do sunni ziyara? No. To do what? To do bid'ah, nafalti ziyara, or polytheism ziyara. Whether they are worshipping Allah in the graveyard, or they are worshipping the grave people. Why did Muslims put these graves into the masjid, into mosques? Why? Because Shaitan is smart. He knows that those people who have buried that good person in the mosque, in the masjid, will not worship them. They will not worship him in the beginning, that's for sure. But later on, maybe next generation, or generation after, or generation after, one day they will fall, and that is exactly what happens in Muslim countries. Go and see. Go to any one of these graves and study the history of it. You will find that he was a pious person. People used to love him because he was a good worshipper. Then he was buried in the masjid. In the beginning, they pass by and say, "Assalamu alaikum dara qawm mu'mineen," like the Sunni ziyara. But later on, next generation, the generation after, the generation, they worshipped him instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a Muslim remember that it is likening, that it is Jannah will be forbidden, that Allah will never forgive him, that he will be settled in hellfire, he will never fall into shirk. He will be so afraid,
so careful not to fall into shirk. Some more. More points to say that shirk is the greatest sin is to say that shirk will nullify all good deeds. And listen to this ayah. I feel this ayah is one of the strongest ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Talking to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. أستغفر الله. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will fall to shirk. لا إله إلا الله. No way. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to show us how great is that sin, shirk, polytheism. How bad it is. So we will not fall into it. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam this way, warning him that if he ever falls into shirk, all his good deeds will be in vain, nullified, fruitless, voided. Then what about us? We poor people, we humble people. So this is really to show us how dangerous is shirk. It is the greatest sin. Every good deed, I told you just a few minutes ago, just imagine a good Muslim who prays five times plus, pay zakah plus, fast Ramadan plus, make Hajj and Umrah plus. And if he does as a mushrik, all these are, you know, in Arabic say habita, yahbitu, hubutan, means khalas, smash. Like if a person is working all his life, gaining money, when he became a millionaire, his money can back this. All of a sudden. What, how he will feel? Probably he will die. What if he loses more, which is more important, a lot more important than money, more than his children, more than his wife, life, more than his whatever he loves? It is his deeds. His deeds which is going to be a reason to get to Jannah, to go to Jannah, and to be saved from hellfire. He will lose it like this, just because he went to these graves and asked them instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if he, or this person, has given what Allah only deserves to be given to someone else other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the other ayah, وَلَوْ أَشْرَكُوا لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. خلاص. Their good deeds will be in vain, lost, fruitless, lost. All these years he was praying, years he was fasting Ramadan, years he was going for Hajj, years he's paying zakah, years he's making da'wah, years he's... And he loses them like this. Why? Because he has fallen into the worst sin, the greatest sin that's ever happened by a human being. Polytheism or shirk. More words to go to show how greatest is this sin. A mushrik, a polytheist, blood, money, life, property will be halal for Muslims. Halal on jihad case, of course, not a personal case. What happened by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What happened by Sahaba, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and the others who have killed people who say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Maybe they are paying zakah and so on, but they are worshipping someone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also. Do you think that Quraysh people were atheists? They were not worshipping anything? They are not believing that Allah is the creator of the universe? No, they were. They used to believe that Allah is the creator of the universe. They used to pray. They used to have some of Ibrahim deen. Millat of Ibrahim was some of it still alive, still available. They used to make Hajj. But they were making these ibadat or worshipping and sharing them between Allah and their God. Listen to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us, telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. Allah! They believe that Allah is the creator and sustainer of the universe. They do some worshipping. Still, Muhammad ﷺ fights them and kills them. So a mushrik, a polytheist, his blood, his life, his money, is halal for Muslims when it comes to the case of jihad. With this in mind. With this in mind. More go. Shirk is the greatest among the great sins. What are the great sins? Zina, drinking alcohol, taking riba, stealing. Okay, these are kaba'ir, major sins. Shirk is worse than all of these. It's the great among these. And that's what you mean by this, the minor shirk, not the major shirk. Major shirk, another case. Yeah. When we say greatest among the great sins, we mean the minor shirk, which is, does not exclude from Islam. As we will talk about this, inshallah, when we talk about the type of shirk. But major shirk is another case. It's not comparable in this case. No way. More to go. Shirk is really a fault and defect, because it is getting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like these things we are worshipping, a'udhu billah. Instead of believing in the greatness of Allah, instead of believing the or glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are comparing Allah to His creatures. We are making Him less than He is subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a really dangerous case. Every Muslim, every human being have the greatness of Allah in his heart, will never associate someone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he knows how great is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah خالق كل شيء الجبار العظيم المتكبر سبحانه وتعالى. How can we put him down subhanahu wa ta'ala? How? Listen to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describing himself and calling him his name, the good name. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله عما يشركون. سبحان الله عما يشركون. All these great names, all these great descriptions of him subhanahu wa ta'ala, how are we going to put him down? The major case, the major reason for Muslims are not really obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completely or correctly is that they do not understand truly the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fearing the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the heart is the major case we have to put in mind always. When we talk about Allah, the greatest subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to be so afraid. See Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how did he pray? Prayer, of course, as you know, salah, it is standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Standing, talking to Allah and Allah talking to us. It is a two-way connection, two-way communication. Standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a Muslim should be really so humble. Khushu' with khushu', he's putting his head down, his eyes down, because he's standing in front of whom? The greatest subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where is the glorification? Where is the greatness of Allah in this case? Not only Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not only Anbiya, also Abu Bakr wa Umar wa Uthman wa Ali radiyallahu anhum, also Tabi'een. Ali ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu, wa an abihi wa an jaddah. He used to come for wudu, and when he starts wudu, he starts to shake. He starts to shake. His face becomes yellow. His face becomes yellow. So people ask him, what happened to you? Why are you? He says, do you know who I am going to stand in front of? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's so afraid. He's feeling that he's going to fail. Yani, just ask yourself, if one of us going to meet the general manager of the company, or the president of such and such, or a minister of such and such, or king or president of, subhanallah al-azim, people will come in so afraid and they are standing like La ilaha illallah. Then when we remember the greatness of Allah, we don't do this. People, when they stand for Salah, what do they do? Play with their shmar, fingers, you hear sound. Maybe he finished Salah. If you ask him, what did you read in Salah? What did you hear in Salah? Salah, I don't know. Shaka Allahu Akbar, Salaamu Alaikum wa Rahmatullah, Salaamu Alaikum wa Rahmatullah. What it was inside this, nobody knows. Almost every Muslim, he will find him feeling far away. Allahu Akbar when he goes to Bombay. Allahu Akbar when he goes to Kharj or Dir'iyya. What happened to Muslims? They missed the greatest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who prayed, as our mother Aisha told us, radiallahu anha, she said, when he starts to pray, you hear his chest like a boiling pot. You know the pot when it's boiling? What happened to it? The chest of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was making sound of crying. He stood sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to pray until his feet was cut and bleeding. Why? Because he was obeying the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Muzzammil. Ya ayyuha al-Muzzammil, qum! قم الليل إلا قليلا نصفه أو قص منه قليلا وزد عليه ورتل القرآن ترتيلا Why? إنا تنلقي عليك قولا ثقيلا. The mission was very heavy case, very heavy coverage. So he needed, Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم needed to be trained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be ready for what he going to receive and carry of this mission to convey this message to the people. A true Muslim, one who says he wants to be a caller for Islam or a preacher for Islam, da'iyah for Islam, he must go through this training. Otherwise he cannot. He will not be capable to continue if he starts. Unless he is really training himself to stand some of the nights facing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking him for the help. He is the greatest subhanahu wa ta'ala. So shirk truly will never happen from a Muslim who really feel the greatest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only those Muslims who really feel the greatest of dunya, the greatness of money, materialistic life, these are only the ones who are not going to be khashi'een in their salah. Put this in mind. Again to say, shirk really is a dangerous case. Dangerous case because these seven topics or matters we have mentioned, we have to put it in mind. Why? Because we need to be safe. We need to be safe from this or this worst of sin ever happened by human beings. To save our Islam, to save our good deeds we have done, not to be nullified or fruitless or voided by shirk, na'udhu billah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us in Jannah as He gathered us in the masjid. Allahumma ya hayyu ya qayyum ya dal jalali wal ikram ya ahadu ya samad. يا من لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد نسألك يا أرحم الراحمين أن ترحم ضعفنا وتجبر كسرنا وتتولى أمرنا وتحسن خلاصنا. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل لا إله إلا الله. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل لا إله إلا الله. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل لا إله إلا الله. اللهم أحينا بلا إله إلا الله وأمتنا على لا إله إلا الله وابعثنا بلا إله إلا الله وأدخلنا الجنة بلا إله إلا الله. اللهم أوردنا حوض نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم أوردنا حوضه وأسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا يا حي يا قيوم يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل ونعوذ بك اللهم من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. اللهم إنا نسألك حبك وحب من يحبك وحب عمل يقربنا إلى حبك. اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى وجنبنا ما تكرهه وتأبى يا حي يا قيوم. اللهم اجعلنا والحاضرين يا حي يا قيوم من الموفقين. اللهم اجعلنا من الموحدين. اللهم اجعلنا من المؤمنين. اللهم اجعلنا من المجاهدين. اللهم اربطنا بأصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم الحقنا بهم يا حي يا قيوم. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تهيئنا في جنات النعيم يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. اللهم لا تحرمنا رؤيتهم في جناتك جنات النعيم يا حي يا قيوم. اللهم اغفر لوالدينا ووالديهم يا حي يا قيوم. اللهم أعتق رقابنا ووالدينا وأحبتنا من النار. اللهم نجينا من النار يا حي يا قيوم. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. صل اللهم وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وجزاكم الله خيرا.